Welcome, I'm Jon Caldara, president of the Independence Institute and your devil's advocate. A little later in the program, we'll be talking about speed traps and cities that thrive on them. But hey, what do you think of the new set? If you like it, I did it all. Not bad, huh? Banged it out over the weekend. If you don't like it, a guy named Julius Ames put it all together and designed it, so his complaints there. I love it. It's great. But first, from the Independence Institute, Linda Gorman, always good to chat with you.
Thank you.
All right, I want to ask you about the flashpoint for the Veterans Administration here in Colorado is this damn hospital that doesn't want to get built somehow. It's starting to remind me of the Big Dig in Boston or light rail here in Denver. What is the problem with building this VA? We need health care for our veterans. This VA is a perfect symbol for most people of taking care of our veterans, and it's not getting built. What's the story?
Well, it's getting built. It's just that its current estimate is $1.7 billion and the cost overrun is $1.1 billion. So it's getting built. It's just getting built
on a government schedule.
On somebody else's money, and so who cares about watching out for costs, right? It's a typical government boondoggle project. The VA wanted to
You say
to
that so callously.
I mean, yeah.
These are our veterans.
They so are.
Is the problem is the problem that it's double the cost, or is the problem that they weren't clear that it's a government project, we're going to rope you in here, but it's really going to be double the cost?
Both. I think double the cost is bad news. Somebody's got to come up with that money. That means I have to work extra hours to pay the taxes that it costs to pay for these mistakes. But the other thing that happened is they went out and they wanted to make this a fashion statement type hospital. Now, no private sector entity would do that. They just want to pay for it, get it done, make it workable, and get out. But no, you know, it's government, so fashion statement type hospital.
What do you mean fashion statement?
Well, big atriums, you know, artwork, have a main street that people can walk along and so forth. And I think Keywood or somebody said that the entrance hall is one of the biggest ever built for a hospital. So
really?
Yeah. So you
so it's grand. It's grandiose.
Yeah, you're an amputee and you're trying to make it across, and good luck with that. You know,
so
it
in the meantime,
next year.
There are veterans who aren't getting the care they need, but we're going to build a beautiful building with a great atrium.
Right.
Nice.
And this isn't the first time that this has happened. This has happened over the last, you know, 60 years. There are constant cost overruns and problems with VA construction.
All right. This is symbolic of the VA in general, isn't it? I mean, now that we've learned that this government-run program is quite literally, and tell me if I'm overstating this, killing people, that there are people who've been dying on waiting lists, and the scandals that have come across in the last year or so of veterans who just can't get the treatment they need. Is it just the VA, or is it something bigger? Why aren't they getting the treatment?
It's a government-run system, and so you see the same things. I mean, they had secret waiting lists for the Arizona Phoenix VA.
What's a secret waiting list?
Well, they weren't supposed to have waiting lists because they were supposed to give people appointments, but they didn't give people appointments, so they had a waiting list that was kept informally that would put people on the appointment list after a certain amount of time had passed. So even though you weren't supposed to have a waiting list and you were supposed to report the waiting list that you did have, they didn't report the waiting list for the waiting list. So yes, people died waiting for care. But this happens in the National Health Service in Britain. It happens in Canada. It happens in every government-run healthcare system that we see. And the reason is that there's no way to know how you should allocate resources. In the private system, if you can't get care from one doctor, you go to another doctor. You know, if you're on a waiting list at one hospital, you can go to another hospital, or you could before Obamacare. But now, And the hospitals get that signal. But if you're in a government-run system and you can't go anywhere, you're stuck.
It's not like you can go to the other VA.
Right.
Whereas the post office, if you don't like the post office, you could go to UPS. You could go someplace else. There really is no other VA except private care. And,
right.
And a lot of veterans use private care.
Yes, they do.
What are the numbers?
There's like 22 million veterans in the U.S. is the estimate. About 9 million of them use the VA for something. Now, that could be inexpensive drugs or hearing aids or whatever.
Wait a second. Let me just take that number. So you're telling me that out of all the veterans we have, only a third of them actually utilize the VA?
Yes.
All right. So out of all the talk we do about the VA, only a third of them actually go to the VA for medical care. What do the other two-thirds do?
Well, most of them have private insurance or Medicare. So you always have the choice in that case of I can go to the VA for some things and I can go to the private sector for other things, or Medicare. And frequently people do that. It may be because they live a long way from a Veterans Administration hospital, or it may be because they don't like the care, or they want it faster, or they don't mind paying a little bit more. We don't really know why, but that's what the VA's own numbers say.
All right. What about the 9 million who do go? All right. So two-thirds decide not to go.
Which in a given year.
Which we should which we should be happy about, shouldn't we? I mean, that's that means that they're being paid someplace else, and you and I taxpayers only have to pay for that one-third, the 9 million.
Well, or they may not need medical care. Remember, in any one year, most people don't need any medical care. True.
You haven't met my family.
Not
all right. So let's go to those 9 million. What do they go there for? Is it just maintenance, or is it the whole? I need a new heart. You're going to go to the VA, and go on the waiting list.
Well, you can go to the VA for almost anything. It's very extensive coverage if you meet one of the priority zones. The notion is that the government said it would provide care for the veterans, but on the other hand, the government also says that, well, we'll only provide as much care as the money we have, and so therefore they have various, I've forgotten, priority classes. And so if you're in priority class one, you're more likely to get immediate care than if you're in priority class eight.
This, you said it's like the Canadian care system, it's like the English nationalized health care. It's take a number. And,
yes.
And depending upon what you have, maybe we can fast track you, but it is take a number care.
Right. The government decides who it's going to treat, where it's going to treat them, and so forth. Yes.
Let me go in two different ways. First, if you could, how would you fix it? And then secondly, as we're watching all these problems and cost overruns and with the VA, is this a lesson for the rest of us as we go towards nationalized health care ourselves? But first, what would you do? All right, you've got this hospital. It's almost double the cost. You've got people on waiting lists till they die. You have secret waiting lists until people die. You've got people being put into priority codes. So, flying on Frontier Airlines now, I get an idea what that feels like. So, what do you do?
And don't forget, you've had these scandals for 60 years, and you've had promises of reform for 60 years, and they keep happening. So the definition of insanity is doing it over and over. So what I would do is say, look, we made this promise. If you serve, we're going to provide medical care for you. It's the same answer as in education or anything else. You voucherize it. You say, here, if you don't like the care we're doing here, you don't have to go through any procedures or whatever. This is how much a procedure costs. Go out and get it somewhere else. Here's a check.
We do it with food stamps.
Yes, we do.
We say, hey, listen, you need it. Here's the cash. Get it done.
Do it with housing.
With housing.
Section 8 housing vouchers, yeah.
But we have to verify the houses. It's not the same.
Food vouchers are pretty straightforward.
Mm-hmm. How do we know that people are making the right calls if you give them a voucher for care? Isn't that the idea of the VA, that these are guys who went through military stuff, they're used to the chain of command, and there are people who know how to allocate these resources better than the veterans?
You're saying that the veterans are too stupid to do what somebody who hasn't enlisted does? I mean, I realize you're not saying that, but that's what people who say that, you know, you need government to tell people what to do. Look, if you're that worried, you could do something like give people a choice. You can either get your care at the VA or you can go somewhere else. And actually, they've started a little teeny program to do that, but the problem is you're not eligible for that program until you've met a whole bunch of VA criteria, so it's still mother may I. You still don't have that choice.
I've heard about this program.
The choice.
What is the choice program?
The choice program. Well, that's basically what it is. If you meet so much waiting and such a criteria, then maybe they'll let you go somewhere.
So if your life really, really, really sucks, and you can document it to
their satisfaction,
then they'll let you out and give you some cash to go buy it where you want to buy it, when you want to buy it.
Yeah, it's a free society, right?
All right. We're all watching this, and we feel bad for our veterans. We feel terrible for our veterans, and that's why there's so much pressure and so much money being put on this hospital, and lots of people are making a lot of money out of it. Good cronyism always. What does it mean for the rest of us? When we see this, is this what Obamacare is going to become?
Yes. It is.
And we we still have private insurance. We're just required to buy private insurance up to a certain standard. It's not that. It's still
You don't have insurance anymore. You have coverage because the government is saying exactly what that insurance policy has to consist of. It's forcing people into very large healthcare organizations called accountable care organizations, and it's flipped the standard of benchmarking from the private sector to Medicare in the private sector. So Obamacare said, instead of benchmarking Medicare to the private sector in terms of waiting and treatments and so forth, now the government's going to tell the private sector what to do in terms of waiting and treatment. This is a big, big change.
I'm not following it. Help me out with this. So I keep hearing, I've got to buy a policy.
Yes.
It is the law.
It is.
We will hold a gun to your head. You must buy this policy.
You could pay the fine. It's a choice.
But
it's
if you don't pay the fine, that's tax evasion, and you can go to jail.
No, actually not. But it's a special kind of tax evasion. They can't actually take your stuff.
They can't take your stuff.
No. They can't put you in jail.
Yet.
They'll change it.
They'll have to change it. All right. But I'm buying a private policy. The same policy I had before covers. I can say, look, I've got the insurance. It's up to your mandate. I've got it. This is not like the VA.
Well, if you buy a private policy from the Colorado Health Exchange, let's say, and you happen to buy the Elevate plan, the only hospital in the plan is Denver Health. And so if you want to use your insurance, you have to do whatever Denver Health says. You can't go elsewhere without paying cash out of pocket. And that's what's happened in a lot of the plans that are available. They're HMO-type plans. They're gatekeeper plans. If you're in one of those, you're stuck like you are in the VA. It's just privately stuck instead of publicly stuck, which is better because they're likely to have fewer rules and be a little bit more flexible. But it's still the notion that the government is trying to make it so that there is somebody else who's dictating what kind of care you can have. Not that you can take your money, go to a doctor, say, treat me. He says, okay, you decide on a price, and you
So watching what's going on in the VA, not just feeling badly for our veterans who deserve so much better and deserve real care, we should look at them and go, that's going to be us pretty soon.
Yeah.
Just plain simple, yeah?
Yes. All right. How do you like that? No two-handed economist here.
Less than a minute left. Tell me a little bit about the Birdwell decision, depending on how it comes out. Does it matter for Colorado because we have our own exchange if the Supreme Court says these exchanges can't be forced?
The thing that that Colorado ought to worry about is if that happens, then states without state exchanges, the businesses will not be penalized for not having a health plan. And if that happens, those businesses have a competitive advantage. And furthermore, most of the people in those states, a lot of them will be exempted from the individual mandate because they won't meet the They won't be their premiums will cost more than 9.5% of income. So it changes the competitive landscape nationally, long term.
What does that mean for us?
For us, it means that it's going to cost businesses more to do business here.
So, if this goes the way I think it might go, those states that only have the national exchange, they will have a competitive advantage to places like us who have a state-run exchange. Mm-hmm. A business might go, it's a lot easier to go to Nebraska and do business there.
Right. Unless, of course, they're foolish and they set up their own exchange. And then they end up taxing. I mean, in Colorado, to run this exchange, we're paying how much now per insurance policy? They're taxing us every which way without, by the way, a Tabor vote because we can't come up with enough money to run this thing.
Basically, we're forced to buy insurance. The fees on those insurance go
skyrocketing
up so that they can pay for the exchange, which we never voted on.
Right. It's easy.
You always make me feel so good. Thank you, Linda. Thank you. Stay tuned. You're going to like this.